motors. They're inherently slow-moving creatures. I would say the average speed of a paramotor is probably going to be flying around 25 miles per hour. Today, I'm going to be doing a little testing on the Cougar 3. If you guys missed one of the last videos, go back and check it out. I did a little first impressions on the Cougar. Essentially, what I found is it's a great cross-country wing, really efficient. So far, it feels fast. I haven't ran any numbers, and it's very stable. It locks into a heading and doesn't want to oscillate. However, one of the things on the website that they advertise on the Cougar 3 is how fast it is. They claim up to 50 miles per hour at full speed. Today, I'm going to test if those claims are true. We're going to try out those three different speed settings. And I went back and looked at an old video I did when I first got my free ride, and I found that the free ride trimmed in neutral was 32 miles per hour. Trimmed out was 36, and trimmed out plus bar was 50 miles per hour. So, what I'm hoping to find out today is if we can break the 50 mile per hour barrier. All right, we are en route to a park that I rarely fly at, but it's one of my favorite spots to fly from. In the back seat, I have the Cougar 3, as well as the Gen Carve. And the Gen Carve I've done a couple videos on. I'm really enjoying it. Part of the plan tonight is I'm gonna let Judson fly it and see what he thinks of it. My goal, on the other hand, is gonna be to fly that Cougar 3, see how fast she goes. I only really have two official flights on the Cougar 3 16 meter. So I'm also gonna try to get a better feel for the wing in general, its handling and all that. If you heard that, but Jeff literally just broke the sound barrier. He's the fastest man alive. You gotta give it to him. Zero wind launch on the Sirocco Mobile. Absolute perfection. I'm just kind of hanging around waiting for Judson to get here because I want to hand off the Carve to him. So he's gonna fly the Carve, get some impressions, see what he thinks of it. I'm gonna go up on the Cougar 3. I got my speed bar set up. We're gonna take her for a freaking rip, see how fast she goes. I feel like Jeff needs some more wadding in his silencer or something. That motor sounds freaking loud. That's my original Icarus motor that Jeff has been flying the piss out of. It's got over 300 hours on it and she's still going strong.
All right, sorry, Justin, buddy. I'm going up without you. Gen Carve is in the bed. Nobody steal it in the meantime. Time to get fired up. Cougar Mobile with its funkalicious toggles. Yeehaw! There's the Judson Mobile! Arriving just in the nick of time. What's up, guy? Nice paramotor, Mr. Sir. It's a lot of electricity. Ty Howler! Oh, touching tips. I want to do some speed runs. And what we have to do for speed runs is we have to do them one direction and then turn around and go the other direction. And I can see some smoke over there, and it looks like the wind is coming out of the direction of the sun. So we'll go into the sun and then away from the sun. Okay, in this direction, into the wind, 25, 26, seems consistent. It's a very light wind day, so good day for speed testing. I would say 25 and a half. Let's turn her around, fly the other way, and then we'll get an average. 180 degrees and 30, 31. Between 25, 26 and 31, I'll give it 28. 28 is the average speed trimmed in. So now let's release these trimmers. They're short little guys, kind of like the free ride has. And now we got 38, 39, 40, 39, 38. I would call that 39 in that direction. Now into the wind, So we said 39. Now we're holding at 34. 33. Yeah, we're holding 34 and we were 39. Well, 36 and a half. Now the moment everyone has been waiting for. Time to engage the speed bar. Cue intense music. So I'm going to do this at a high altitude. Using speed bar in general, you should either be using it at a higher altitude or above water in a slalom competition, because it does increase your risk factor. And this is a brand new wing, so given that, I want to take it high for the first couple tries. Let's give our speed bar a whirl. Seen. Okay. Give me a second to get some more altitude. I was not expecting that. That was fast. I don't know if I can even publish these numbers. Dude, my helmet started to blow back. Jesus. Okay, let's try that again. I saw 56 momentarily. I'm gonna do this one downwind. That. I felt that shit coming. Woo-wee! Alright. I'm gonna stow my phone and we'll pull the trimmers in. And, woo! Glad that didn't f*** her. So what happened there, boys and girls? We're going really freaking fast. I saw 56 again, and I felt like we had a little asymmetric collapse there at full speed, and I'm not going to revisit that, because I don't want to die, actually. So the thing with going really, really fast on these gliders is you're pitching the wing down, and pitching it down puts it in an attitude that is prone to collapse. And if you get to a certain threshold, the wing will collapse. And if it collapses at full speed, it gets really, really bad. And I'm thankful that that didn't get really, really bad. But that was scary. I don't feel particularly safe going full speed like that for an extended amount of time. So I'm gonna call that fast as shit.
Alright, so boy, do we have some things to debrief. Before we get into this debrief, quick shout out, I just want to let you guys know, all of these shirts and sweatshirts down below on tuckergott.com are currently 15% off for a limited time. If you want to go down there and pick up some sweet merch while it's cheaper than normal, go check it out. Okay, with that out of the way, let's talk about this Cougar 316 and the little experience I had on it going full speed. So I'm going to talk about some like really basic stuff first before we get to the actual incident. Gliders are generally rated from beginner to intermediate, and you go from A, B, C, and then you get to the unrated. What this scale essentially establishes is safety in the beginning on your A-rated glider. When you slide down the scale to unrated, you get to gliders that are big question marks. They either haven't been tested or wouldn't pass the tests, and it's kind of up to the user to kind of take on the responsibility of understanding that and using it how they seem fit. So this Cougar 3 is an unrated glider. It's at the end of that spectrum at the advanced level. And in addition to that, there's different size gliders. So from 16 all the way up to, I don't know, 20 something that they make this glider in, 16 is the very smallest of those gliders. And if you look at the big picture, if you take any unrated 16 meter glider, you can get into some really weird stuff. You can find that these gliders are a different breed. They will have weird characteristics because Aerodynamically, when you scale things smaller and smaller, sometimes they don't work the same as when they're scaled much bigger. I think it's really important for any pilot to understand that if they're flying an unrated glider, they have to respect it, and especially an unrated 16 meter glider. And then even more especially, if they're going out and pushing full speed on it. That's like the triple trifecta combo of if something goes bad, that's kind of the absolute worst case scenario for your glider to blow up. Really small size, unrated, and full speed. When I first got into the sport and I was starting to progress up to more advanced wings, I didn't necessarily respect that fact very much myself. I can remember my first 16 meter wing just going out and pushing the speed bar at a couple hundred feet and assuming that everything was gonna be okay. But now I look back on that, and now that I know more, I understand that that stuff should be done at a much higher altitude, at least until you build confidence and understanding on that specific wing at your specific weight, at your specific altitude, or be doing it over water with support from a slalom team, that sort of thing. That is the exact reason why, in this case, I went up to about 1,200 feet, which in retrospect, I should have actually gone even higher. Now, some more basics for you guys. Paramotor pilots will know this, but non-paramotor pilots, this is your trim and speed bar system. On the back of the risers, we have the little trim tabs that you see me letting out. And what that basically does is it extends the lines on the rear of the glider. That changes the angle of attack of the wing to more of a negative angle of attack, kind of like a spoiler on a car. That reduces drag and makes you fly faster. The speed bar is that bar you see on my feet, which is connected to two lines that come up and yank on the front of the risers. Now, when you push your feet down, it pulls the front lines on the glider, further decreasing the angle of attack on the glider. Both of these two things, trim and speed bar, decrease the angle of attack and make you go a lot faster. One thing to note as well, the brake lines were at factory length. I never modified them because modifying them could increase the likelihood of that collapse happening. They were at factory length. One thing I also want to note is when I was doing these tests, the air was absolutely smooth. Down low, up high, no matter where you went, there were no bumps going on that day. It was pretty much the perfect day to go flying. So I can say confidently that it's not that I hit a bump and the bump caused the collapse. It was perfectly smooth air, and I think it was purely something going wrong with the glider design. So first up, I did the trims, non-event, totally fine. Next, when I went to trimmed out plus the speed bar, which is a configuration that you're allowed to use this glider in, so I pushed the speed bar, and I've run speed bar on a lot of 16 meter wings, and immediately I could feel that this one was different. I was going so damn fast, my helmet was blowing back, I felt like I could see the angle of the glider in my peripheral, and it was just pitched straight down. I was at full power and I felt like I was still descending. I was going ridiculously fast, and the numbers reflected that. I was 7.5 miles faster than I've gone on any other glider. So that was a little red flag to me, and I was like, wow, this is different. This is unique. Let me get a little more altitude. I was still down to push it a second time and see what was up. So I turn at 180, I push the speed bar, same sort of thing is happening. I'm like, oh my God, this is going really fast. So as soon as I got kind of leveled out at full speed, it just felt like I got punched. So immediately I went into recovery mode, backed off of power, backed off the speed bar, and everything settled down. Now, you may ask yourself, looking at this footage, an ordinary person might say, well, that wasn't that big of a deal. It was only like this much of your wing that came in and collapsed. Here's the thing. When you're flying at your slowest speed setting, you're going, what was it, 26 some miles an hour? Not very fast. When I was at full speed, I was pushing 57.5 miles per hour. That's about double of what you're going at the slowest speed. Now, when you're going that fast and you take a collapse, things happen exponentially worse. Had that collapse gone any further and the whole wing could have disappeared, and then recovery after that is very seldom even possible. I know of several different situations where this has happened, taking a full frontal collapse at full speed. And a good buddy of mine, Johnson, shout out to Johnson, He took a full collapse like that, full speed, and it was essentially not recoverable. He just threw his reserve and landed in a lake under his reserve. That would be exactly what could have happened to me if it had gone any worse. So after this event happened, I reported my findings back to the guys at Team Fly Halo to inform them that, hey, this happened and it's an obvious safety concern. I want to publish this and tell you guys what I found so that other people don't go out there and put themselves in this situation and end up getting hurt because of it. They're very understanding of this. The thing I want to make known is that this is specifically the Cougar 3 16 meter. I can't vouch for the 18, the 20, or any other bigger sizes, but I would speculate that the problem probably goes away as you get to the bigger sizes. All I can say is that I know for sure on the 16 meter, I personally would not go up and push full speed under any circumstances. All I want you guys to know is if you're a paramotor pilot and you end up buying this wing, specifically the 16, or you have any friends that have the 16, please let them know to check this video out and make a judgment for themselves and be extraordinarily careful on the 16, because I don't want to see anyone else get hurt. So I want to leave you guys with some overall thoughts on this wing. Before this flight even happened, I pretty much already knew that this wasn't going to be my next daily driver wing. And the main reason was because it didn't have that slalom response rate that I'm looking for in a wing. It has the cross-country stability, which is what it was designed for. And I thought it was a great wing for that purpose, but not specifically what my tastes are looking for. Now, looking at just the specific 16 meter model, does the top speed make it a wing that I would never fly in general? I guess the answer is yes and no. After this happened, it wouldn't be a wing that I would own, because personally, I want to have a wing that I can use the whole range of confidently. I don't want there to be this zone, if you push 75% bars are going to collapse, if you push 80, 100, like at what point does things start to go wrong? So with that, I don't think it would ever be a wing that I would own, but it is a wing that I would still fly and feel confident on as long as I didn't use the speed bar or I only use, say, up to 50% speed. So overall conclusion, I guess I would fly this 16 meter glider again. I would just not use the bar to the full extent. And the speed bar isn't something I typically use at all. So honestly, if I flew it again, I would just leave the bar off and not mess with it. But I would still fly the 16 Cougar 3 just using the trims, and I would feel confident that nothing bad was gonna happen. I hope that makes sense to you guys, and I wanna be really transparent about things. As you guys know, I have no brand loyalty. I don't love or hate any specific brand. But at the end of the day, it's a specific wing, a specific size, all these specific circumstances that come down to my thoughts on telling you guys that you should be careful at full speed on this glider. I hope you guys enjoyed this episode. I've sent the wing back. So on to the next one. I'm not sure what the next one may be. I'm thinking at this point in time, all I have to do is just sit down and take the time to figure out the colors, and I think I'm gonna order another Freeride 16. Make sure you check out the 15% off code down in the description. I'll see you guys in the next episode. Till then, peace.